I think there are two things which become very clear when you sit in this part of the world rather than some of the other bits of the world. One is the fact that so a lot of Europe's future is being determined not in Paris or in Berlin, but in Moscow and in Ankara, and you're both more expert at studying these great powers, but you also realise how much they can reshape the European neighbourhood in a way that everybody else is starting to learn through the refugee crisis, through what's happening in Syria, in Ukraine. But secondly, you have a different sensibility in a country that's been through a profound change of the political order, which is incredibly helpful when dealing with a world which is becoming unhinged and where big things are changing. there is a sort of, I think, calm in the face of the storm which you get in places which have been through big changes and survived and come out stronger on the other side, which you maybe don't get in countries that have had a more stable recent political history. And it's maybe worth starting with that big kind of fact, that because it's not just Europe which is changing, which is going through profound changes. It's the whole world around us at the moment. I think there is a sense that we, after several decades, when the world was coming together economically, when borders were coming down, when barriers between nations and peoples were being ripped apart, and where people saw enormous opportunities as a result of globalization and these links which were being forged across the world between different nations, there is now a shift in attitude to all of those forces, and a sense that they are also profoundly destructive and disruptive of people's certainties. They're reshaping economies. A lot of people feel left behind, see their wages stagnating, seeing the downside of their own personal circumstances, even as the national economy grows and companies make bigger profits and the finances behind them get richer and richer. But also the communities are being changed. People are leaving from some countries, leaving their families and the resources behind and taking their energies to other places. And in other areas, you have an influx of people who may be in the economy, but they change the social structure of the place and put pressure on public services, on schools and hospitals, on housing. And that is overlaid with a kind of broader shift in power on the world stage from west to east. An increasing situation where a lot of the institutions which were meant to overlay that and give political order and ensure that the rule of law worked internationally are becoming contested and getting bogged down. So there is a sense that the liberal order at a global level is unraveling. So that's the sort of global context, the growing movement against globalization, against liberalization, against the kind of ideas of liberal democracy. And in every part of the world, there is much more geopolitical competition. In Asia, in the Middle East in particular. And the European story which we're living through is a sort of microcosm of that bigger story. And I think that when we talk about the future shape of Europe, there are huge amount of uncertainties at the moment, partly because of the Brexit. The fog of Brexit has still not risen, so I have no idea how that's going to be worked out in my country. But also, national politics is so difficult to understand in other places that this could just be the first of many big upsets. We have all the elections that we know are going to take place in France, in the Netherlands, in Germany, the referenda that's going to take place in Hungary and in Italy. But also, we did some work and we found that there are 55 insurgent parties around the European Union which are calling for 34 extra referendums on EU-related issues. And that just leads to a change in the way that the politics works. So there is a lot of uncertainty, but within that, I think that it seems pretty clear that we are at the end of an era where the old way that we thought about the European Union as this project where you countries were coming together towards an ever closer union with a number of different central integration drivers, the Eurozone, Schengen, the single market, the European Defence Corporation, that they're all kind of moving in parallel with each other and people were being bound together ever more tightly. Even as the EU continued to expand and bring in extra members from the outside, so that you had a sort of idea of a unipolar European order where the European Union, under the security of NATO, would determine the rules for our part of the world. That idea has been blown up by what's happening. So I think when we think about the future shape of Europe, we need to think about it through a series of different circles. So within the EU itself, we have to think about several different Europes, because each of the crises which is affecting Europe is straining the idea of solidarity and splitting the European Union in new ways. There's the Euro crisis, which has created a massive schism within the Eurozone between North and South, creditors and debtors. But also there is a pretty painful divide between countries in the Euro and outside the Euro. If Britain leaves, the balance of power is going to change and make it more uncomfortable for countries outside of Europe. There is an ongoing debate about the future of the European economy and how that kind of changes, because we have a single market in name only, because most economic activity is not about goods, it's about services, it's about digital, and these things, there is no single market in those areas. And the differences in income and wealth between countries like Bulgaria and Luxembourg become so great that it is putting pressure on the kind of third set of issues, which is about borders and the idea of free movement, which is being challenged from two angles, both from the refugee crisis angle, where it's about the external borders of the European Union, the way that countries work together, but also on the internal question. It was, to the extent there was one thing that drove the debate in Britain, it was very much about the free movement of labour, but that debate is going to come back in different forms through debates over the posted workers directive in France and Belgium and in other sorts of places. And then there's another big European project around the defence of the European Union and the prospect of Donald Trump entering the White House and the US withdrawing from Europe does mean that Europe's going to have to think about defending itself in different ways. And those four crises which split Europe in different ways between East and West, North and South, result in quite different Europes, because some of the countries that need to be in the economic Europe might not get into the Euro or be in the Schengen zone, etc. And then beyond that, there is this whole question of this bigger crisis of European order, where you have a lot of countries that are inside the European security space, but will probably never be in the European Union, or certainly not in the near future, starting with the Balkans, where the Western Balkan countries are completely bound up with our idea of security. They're totally inside the European security space. And if there are... So therefore, just thinking about the absence of war for the Balkans is not a good enough idea about European order. We care about how these countries are governed. We care about stopping radicalization in those countries. We need to be ready to get involved if things go wrong. But they probably won't be in the European Union. And then beyond that, there are other countries like Georgia, Moldova, Ukraine in particular, that are contested. It's important to us that they don't go completely into the Russian sphere of influence, that they have control over their own affairs and over their own borders, but they're not in NATO, they're not in the European Union. And that the question of how we relate to them is very complicated, because we've traditionally thought about that as through the prism of enlargement, but without actually offering the prospect of membership. So how we engage with those countries is complicated. And then the biggest challenge is actually outside that. It's going back to the kind of Bulgarian lesson for me, which is to think about Russia and Turkey and how we relate to them. And our relationships are incredibly complicated with both of these countries at the moment. They're enormously divisive for European Union issues. And there are no pan-European institutions which allow us to talk to all of them and to deal with the management, not just of the internal European space, but the neighbourhoods which surround us. Because at the moment you have not one European order, but there is an EU European order. There's a Russian European order with a lot of its own institutions like the Eurasian Economic Union. And there's a Turkish attempt at an order. It changes sometimes. Sometimes it's about zero problems with the neighbours, other times it's about zero neighbours without problems. But what is clear is that they want to have relationships with all these different people, and how we all relate to each other is enormously complex. So just to end, I've already spoken for longer than Vesa had asked me to. I think it's going to be a really, really complicated, lively and important debate about how we develop all of these different things. And it's a debate which will have all sorts of implications, economic, legal, institutional, and it will also be very much part of national politics, because in all of our countries, the whole future shape of Europe has become one of the top issues on which political parties are campaigning and around which people are mobilizing. And it's going to need quite a lot of creativity and flexibility and to think in much more complicated ways. And unlike earlier phases of European integration, where Paris and Berlin could come together and work out a blueprint and then other people had to work out if they liked it or not and might make changes in the middle of it. I've been in both Paris and Berlin recently. We're going to hear from our colleagues later. I don't think they have a plan yet. And I'm not sure that they're actually ever going to have a plan which works for all of these different things. And their perspectives are very, very different, because the urgency of these crises are different, and the Europe that emerges won't be a single Europe, but many different Europes. So it's very important that Bulgaria gets involved in these debates, both because of the unique sensibilities that you can bring with it, but also because I think you can actually shape this in a way that you maybe couldn't think about shaping the debates about the European Constitution and the Lisbon Treaty and other things, not just because you weren't in the European Union, but because those were things where Paris and Berlin were so much more in control of them.
If you rewind, for those who have been around in the big rounds of EU reform debates that we have had, you will certainly remember a Germany that had EU reform debates that were very narrowly often focused on institutional questions and questions of treaty reform. That was really the case throughout the 90s and the big rounds of treaty reform post-Maastricht that then led to the very important Nice Treaty, of course, that accommodated with very complicated institutional questions the growth of our union and Germany, and then the constitutional attempt, the European Convention. These were really, from a German point of view, very important battles to be fought, because the German approach has been, alongside with partners in Europe, to say we overcome geography and the problems that come with our geography and our European space. In something that is a political system where institutions and rules and relations between these institutions, and I'm really keen to hear from the Honourable Member of the European Parliament about that, to really settle these questions of contested geography in which Germany played such a crucial and devastating role for so many times, into an institutional settlement and architecture that would then bring about a peaceful Europe, a prosperous Europe. And I remember traveling around personally, working very much on this angle of EU reform, that you really annoyed people a lot who wanted to talk substance. And said, well, what is it actually that this system is supposed to be producing? And one thing I wanted to point out, which I think is an important shift in the German conversation, Germany has not fully abandoned, of course, its adherence to the EU institutions, and that is very important still to see, and to see a lot of engineering still when it comes to, at least with modest success, try to reform here and there the Eurozone constellation, which is about procedures, but this is not the major focus. The major focus has become on substance, and that is what Mark talked about, the prosperity and the security of our citizens in Europe. Which is really quite interesting because it also is a different conversation in Berlin now. It brings different people in with different views on these questions. Some people that were around the tables very naturally that negotiated those treaties are less so present around the tables, which I think is also sometimes a painful learning. But it really is a different environment in which the question is also going beyond the EU as an umbrella and is really starting from the question. And Germany is very clear on that still, even though we can talk about the domestic developments in Germany and new parties and movements that are challenging Germany's Europe orientation and some of its policies. But the government of Angela Merkel has made it very clear, especially in the moment of the Brexit vote, that Germany firmly sees its future as part of the European Union, and that one of the major arenas and instruments in which Germans, alongside with others, want to pursue and prosperity and security is the EU framework, no doubt about that. I think that was a very important signal to be sent. And this is something we should not, of course, put into fundamental question with regard to this government, but there's a wider conversation that says, acknowledging that the system is far from perfect. Mark talked about the dysfunctional size of the EU system that is very much acknowledged. But it is taken into account, and the question then is, what other instruments do we have? What other arenas do we have? What other means do we have that might not sum up into something that looks like a nice edifice as we would with probably our continental European taste for architecture, think of a beautiful piece, but that looks rather messy and with a lot of darker pockets and corners and a lot of things that are a bit more blurry and some sharp edges. This is something that also encompasses other formats and forums where NATO plays a strong role, where at the moment the OSCE plays a strong role for the German government being in the lead for the time being, where just the sheer will of countries to sit around tables to listen and communicate, which we thought we can take for granted as EU members, but I believe we no longer can always. This can take various shapes and forms. So the future architecture of Europe from a Berlin perspective, in my view, has a lot of components. And this doesn't make the conversation easier at all. Actually, it makes it more difficult because it really poses the question of, in a way, which instruments you draw on at what times, who is supporting that, building coalitions, and acknowledging, of course, as Berlin does, the Franco-German couple is not enough, it needs others. We see a situation in which a lot of the domestic environments are shaping what governments can do at EU level, sometimes no matter how strong their EU commitment is. All that is known. All that is known. And yet there is a strong determination to make this future architecture work with all the blurriness that might come with that. And I think this is also a difficult learning process for those in Germany that tended to look at the Union as something relatively rigid and homogenous, and something where you can say, these rules apply and these don't, and these countries are in and these countries are out. I'm exaggerating because it was never really like this, and I say that a place where you know very well that being in can mean also different things and participation in not all policies, but the German understanding has been, probably because our brains were like that, we like to keep things black and white at times, a rather rigid understanding. And the new understanding needs to be one that is a lot more blurry and a lot less clear-cut when it comes to the instruments we have at hand and the policies that we can shape and the geography we're looking at. So it is a completely different environment. What I find fascinating to see is that while it was, as Vesela pointed out, very clear in the past who had a certain sense of ownership for the EU reform debate. Mark talked about the French and the Germans. We know beach walls annoy a lot of countries that feel they're marginalized, and I think for absolutely the right reasons. To me, it's not very clear-cut these days who really owns the EU reform debate, because there are a lot of different reform debates happening, and it's very legitimate in a political battle of ideas to bring them to the fore and to try and cluster coalitions around your ideas, and that's what's happening. And that is a different environment in which European Union policies work, and that is European Union politics, really, where we see a lot of contestation, challenge, conflict. The modus operandi of the EU has become one where we see less harmony and less pulling in one direction, but we see individual countries, groups of countries pulling into all sorts of directions. And we talk a lot about the centrifugal forces in the EU, which I think, yes, no doubt about that, we need to acknowledge them. And there's really very often no clear path that you could see EU countries sort of walking on jointly. But I think we should also step back a little bit at times and ask ourselves to what extent that is also a sign of a political system that has entered a mode that we are more or less familiar with in our nation states. The things that are being negotiated in the European Union, in particular in the Eurozone, but also in other EU member states, the things that we try to do together are by no means some ornamental little things. They are massive. We are negotiating common goods, and we know how difficult that is at national level. And we see that playing out at EU level very dramatically. I have time for one final point. Yes, okay. Yes, okay. Now, I just wanted to talk a little bit about the role of Germany when it comes to its ability to bring together countries. It is really an old debate also within ICFR by now to look at Germany's role in terms of its leadership and the expectations that come with that, but also the problems that come with that. And I feel while, and we did a survey on that as well, where we asked experts and policymakers in all EU member states, what are the most important countries for you to work with, where are you looking when you want to solve problems, and that, of course, Germany is very much at the core of that. And Berlin policymakers have accepted and taken on that role, even in areas where this was not the natural sort of inclination or reflex, that is in security and defense policies. But I think there's less so an awareness amongst German policymakers what German power does to others and to the EU system as such. And we've seen that play out over the past couple of years on a number of occasions. Where, of course, when Germany moves, it's not irrelevant, it is very relevant, that it has systemic relevance, and it can change things, and it can change the way that others look at things. And I find it is a particular challenge for us, as ECFR in Berlin, to help Germany understand that with mostly, I have to say, the conversations I have, with mostly really good intentions and a firm idea of Germany's Europeanness and the willingness to work together, I don't think Berlin is always getting it quite right in understanding what the views of others are. And we feel there is great room for improvement, which is what we're trying to do partly with the work that Vesela talked about. We draw on the expertise from within ECFR. I think you were with us 2 weeks ago, Vesela. Mark is with us tomorrow. Manuel is coming a lot. For us, it's a very important resource to help keep Germany engaged in the European way. Because we're a big country, we can talk a lot to each other, and our language is sometimes a hurdle. But what we really need is to keep a European conversation going in Berlin that helps Germany understand the wider dynamics. And I think there's a role that is, of course, only in a limited way can be played by officials and MPs, certainly, but a lot for think tanks as well.
The debate about Europe in France and about the future of Europe as being for a long time between pro-European and anti-European, and now it's been shift very significantly in terms of people are not anti-European, they want another European Union, another European project. And there are two ways to look at this. The first way to look at this is to say this is a victory for the European sentiment, for the fact that there's a French commitment to its European destiny. But that's also how the dissenting minority became a majority. And that's how the referendum on the EU constitution, the draft constitution in 2005 was lost. That's how there was a majority against, because people didn't feel that they were opposing Europe, they felt that they were opposing a certain direction for Europe and they wanted another one. And obviously the problem is that there was no shared view between those who opposed the draft constitution about what that other direction would be. Some people would say that there were not a lot of vision at all, but that's unfair. But it's clear that at least there were very different visions, and none of them would be able to coalesce a majority within the French voters. It's already an issue that you vote for against something and you don't have a plan B. We've been there already more than 10 years ago. So that's left the pro-European political class with a major political trauma. And right now you have two contradictory impulses. The first one is a overall tendency to believe that there's a solution in further integration. And on a lot of issues on Schengen, the French are pushing for the security dimension of Schengen and the external border control. And that's, for instance, in transforming Frontex into a more integrated border guard body on defense. And I could name many others, and I will actually name them later. And the other contradictory impulse is the strong sense that there's a need to rally people's support for Europe, that we can't move on anymore, move any further without that people's support. And actually, I'm saying that the 2005 no at the referendum was a trauma for a lot of people in the political class, but that doesn't mean that people think that in no way there should be a referendum. Actually, you see, since 2005, you've seen in France a lot of political leaders say we need a referendum, not on whether we should exit or not the EU, but on, for instance, enlargement. And there was even a change in the French constitution at some point that any enlargement would be subject to a referendum. After the Brexit referendum, one of the contenders for the primary race on the right-leaning side of the political spectrum came with the idea that if he was elected president, he would come with a referendum on what the new project, his new project for Europe would be, to get the popular support, because that would make him stronger, and then he could go and talk to his fellow European leaders. So this contradiction is reflected in the French position on treaty change, treaty modification. There was a lot of discussion about whether there could or should be a treaty modification, including when people were trying to avoid the Brexit. And there was a negotiation between the UK and the 27 others. And the French view was that, so there are issues with the kind of modification that the UK could pursue, but in any case, if there was a treaty change, and France had its own view about what kind of changes would be needed, but the key parameter was that this would happen after the 2017 election, both in France and in Germany. You need something, and you need it so strong, further integration, that it probably takes a treaty modification to move forward, because we are talking about structural changes, not just policy changes. But this is very complicated to rally the people's support, and you can't move ahead without that people's support. So when you have this kind of conversation right now in France, you see there's a lot of interest for the idea of a two-speed Europe. You hear or read about the need for a political core, are about a Eurozone government, and actually the Eurozone should also have its budget and its parliament. These are another few ideas of the more integration impulse that I was talking about. You have on defense the idea that there could be several initiatives, including resorting to the so-called permanent structured cooperation provision, which would allow a few member states to cooperate further, especially on capabilities, military capabilities. But all those ideas actually are very rarely followed upon, because there is this kind of contradiction or difficulty that people keep on facing and don't have a solution with, which I would sum up in these two problems. The first one is that the member states that want to stay in the slow lane, if you think in terms of a two speed, are actually impacted by what the member states in the fast lane are doing. And that's what happened with the UK discussion. The UK doesn't want to join the euro, but want to have a say on what the eurozone countries decide, because it says it impacts, and it's fairly enough, it says it impacts its own situation. And there's the same on defense. And there's the same on many other issues. And the other problem is that those in the fast lane don't want those in the slow lane to be too slow. And that's, again, was reflected in the debate about Brexit, where the French position was insisting that, for instance, the four freedoms is a package. You can't pick one or two or three and leave the others. So if you have a multi-speed Europe, you can't have a Europe à la carte. There's a basis of a fixed menu that you need to stick with. And that was the position of France prior to the vote, and it is still the position now that there will be a negotiation about the new kind of relation and the access to the single markets that the EU will give to the UK. The UK wishes to ask for it. Right now, this is something similar to what Helmut was saying, more than institutional or architectural issues. The French priorities are about how to secure EU citizen support. There's the idea that before going towards further integration, you first need to get that kind of support. And so you have these will to get a Europe that responds to the people priorities and that deliver results. And that's the agreements that you've seen between President Hollande and Chancellor Merkel and Prime Minister Renzi ahead of Bratislava on three priorities: domestic and external securities, that is borders, terrorism, and defense. Second priority is strong economy and a strong social cohesion, which is not a code name for further integration of the Eurozone, even though that would be welcome from the French perspective, but it's about unemployment, investment, digital single markets, energy, research, innovation, etc. And then the third priority is an ambition for youth. You can't have a Europe that works and is compelling to its people if the youth do not see what's in it for them, and so you need more jobs, more training, and more support for entrepreneurship. I don't think that it's likely that you see anything more than what I just did refer to before the 2017 election. And obviously the question, as Pesela rightly framed it, is what will happen after the election. And if I knew it, I wouldn't be here. I would be making a lot of money in other places. But let me tell you what I think. And that's more, that's the part where I could be really wrong very soon. But I try to say things as I see them. There's a variety of options. The campaign is still at very early stage. You have primary processes. It's not like the US, but you have the same phenomenon that what happened in the primary and what happened in the real election is quite different, so it's quite a little bit difficult to say. But my guess is, first, whatever the results, I don't think there will be a Brexit. I know a lot of people after the Brexit were calling me at the Paris office and asking, so when is the Brexit going to happen? I don't think there's a Brexit happening. And I don't think for two reasons. I believe it won't be the case because I believe Marine Le Pen won't be elected. And even though, even if she were to be elected, I believe that the Front National actually has shifted in the spirit of what I said at the beginning, that you can't be anti-European and believe that you will rally a majority around you. You have to say there's another way to do things. And obviously that can be very disruptive and destructive, but you have to go for something much more ambiguous. And the Front National now has a very more limited position on exiting the euro and not exiting the EU, and more ambiguous because they don't say we will exit the EU, they say we will negotiate with Brussels, very much like Cameron tried to do, and we'll get a deal, and if the deal is not satisfactory, then we'll put the deal to a referendum, and we'll see if the French people want to leave the euro.
But Sarkozy said something similar yesterday, no?
So, this is not just about Sarkozy says he wants Sarkozy says he wants new treaty, and that leads me to my beyond the Frexit point. My guess is that what is going to happen. First option is you have the usual French rhetoric on refundation, and that's very much what Sarkozy said. But that's not only Sarkozy. People fixate on Sarkozy because he has this kind of very fascinating personality. But most French leaders, before they are elected and even right after they are elected, say, okay, I will come with those great ideas and I will put them on the table and all my fellow EU partners will see them and see the light and say, oh, of course, the French are right, this is the truth, capital T. We like it very much, let's do that, we're convinced. And so there is this idea that the French vision of Europe will be the basis for the refoundation of Europe. The second option is that we will not focus on that kind of very architectural or institutional issues and we'll much more focus on rules. And you can see right now in the political campaign debates about abiding by the budget deficit rules, for instance. And strangely enough, whereas France's official forecast is that next year will at last respect the 3% deficit rule, you see people on the right side of the political spectrum, not on the left side as you can could have expected, saying, well, the hell with those rules, let's not respect them. But you also have Prime Minister Valls who says that the posted workers directive is a problem and that if it's not renegotiated in a satisfying manner, then France may not abide to it. So you might have a debate that would be much less about the architecture and the overall institutional approach and much more about the rules in vigor and how you accept those rules to be imposed on you. And then there's a third option which is focusing on the people's needs and priorities and right now that's what the president is trying to do with the chancellor, the German chancellor. But that can take a lot of very different forms and not be European at all. And of course, all the three options can combinate very easily. And usually, that is my guess that it's what will happen because that's what is happening anyway, every time. And the problem is how long does it take the French leaders to realize that these are dead ends and that you need to actually come with a real policy that changing Europe will be a slow process, that yes, architecture is important and we need to have a vision for it, but that there is the French leadership, if it exists, has its limitations. I'm always struck that when I'm going in other ECF offices that so many people speak about German leadership, and in France you never speak about German leadership, you only speak about the Franco-German couple. The idea that there would be a German leadership without the French being around is just absence of the conversation. So you need to realize that this French leadership, and I think there's some kind of leadership, has its limitation, that there's a diversity of view and perspectives, and a diversity of shapes that the Europe will take, and my hope is that at least we will not start again from scratch, and that in the meantime, in that transitional moment where we go through our usual kind of reaction is too long, that the frustration doesn't grow further. Actually, this is more or less a similar story than Helmut's it's not the same kind of focus on institution in France than in Germany, but there is a fondness for the debate on architecture and institution in France in its own right, and it's still there. If you look at the French ideas on how to make progress on the European defense front, it's very much about institutions. So I believe, on a personal basis, that the substance is the way forward. And often, and even more since this 2005 referendum traumatism, substance is part of the conversation in France, but very much with a defensive and a protection-focused agenda. And my own sentiment is that Europe, as well as France, would be much more better off with a more positive agenda, and that's what I think we need.
Нас от българите, влизането на България в Европейския съюз е един вид завръщане в демократичния цивилизован свят, от който беше покъсната България, както и голямата част от Източна Европа след 1944-1945 година. Затова и желанието да сме единни, да останем в Европейския съюз, да участваме активно в формирането на този Европейски съюз, все още е много голямо в България и въпреки различните политически играчи, които се опитват да използват както в други страни антиевропейска риторика, в България има сериозно мнозинство за това България да е част от европейското семейство и разбира се, това европейско семейство да остане единно на позицията на официалната позиция на България, че искаме запазване на единството на Европейския съюз. Ние сме срещу фрагментирането, срещу дискусията за бъдещето на Европа да бъде водена в групи, подгрупи, а не в формата Европейски съюз 27, след Брексита. И особено след резултатите от референдума в Великобритания се даде нова мотивация за дебата, какво се случва в Европа и какво трябва да направим, за да възстановим, както и Мона каза, много важно, за да гарантираме това, че нашите европейски граждани продължават да вярват, че по-е добре да сме заедно, отколкото по-отделно всяка страна се справя с глобалните предизвикателства, които са пред нас. Едно от тях е миграцията, тероризма, но ако искате и конкурентоспособността, околната среда, енергийните източници и външната политика като играч на световната сцена на Европейския съюз, за сега, разбира се, се представя, за съжаление, за съжаление, незадоволително. Това е позиция на България да намери първо в достатъчно гъвкавост в съществуващите договори, но и да търсиме възможности за всички тези теми. Еврозона. Ние не харесваме, разбира се, определенията ядро и периферия. И в Хостата, и в проекта доклада съм внесъл поправки, където искам премахването на тази дума, защото какво означава периферия? Ние сме в момента от ядрото на бурята или на кризата по отношение на миграцията. Страни, изключение на Великобритания и Дания, които са заявили, че имат изключение и няма да влезнат в еврозоната, няма да участват в еврозоната, всички други страни, когато са готови, ще влезнат в еврозоната. Така и България се стреми за приемане в ЕРМ механизма и след това, когато сме готови и в самата еврозона. Много е, според нас, опасно това разделяне и фиксиране на кой принадлежи към ядрото и кой е извън това. Но, от друга страна, Европейския съюз, разбира се, ние признаваме, и то е така, е съюз на суверенни страни. И фактически колегата Питър Хофстад в неговият проект и доклад, аз тук ще съобща на вас, на аудиторията, че след Брексит в Европейския парламент имаме няколко доклада, по които се работи. Един от тях е на Хофстад за възможно развитие и адаптиране на съществуващата институционална структура на Европейския съюз. След това са докладите на Брок Пресо за използване потенциал на Лисабонския договор и на други БРС за бюджетния капацитет, както и очакванията от групата на високо равнище по собствените ресурси. Това, което е в договор в проекта доклада на Гита Хостат, интересно от гледна точка и на, на едно предишно предложение на Ендрю Дъв за федерализма и за как може да функционира по-ефективно Европейския съюз, тези страни, които искат Европа алака или така наречената променлива геометрия, искат изключения по най-различни политики, да им бъде предоставен статут на нов статут на асоциирани членове, като примерно страни като Великобритания, бъдеще може би и Турция, и по-нататък може би Украина при невъзможност за пълно членство. По този начин да не се блокират обаче другите страни, които искат така речения Европлоза Юния или по-тесен съюз, по-единен съюз. И Европа на различни скорости, срещу което сме ние, не означава обаче, че не може да има и по-тясна интеграция между тези страни, които изявяват желание това да се случи, и другите страни, които обаче не желаят това да се случи, имат проблеми по ратификацията на определени политики, да не бъдат заложници другите на вътрешно-политическите проблеми на съответната страна, като Чехия, Дания или някоя друга страна, някоя политика може да има проблеми си и самата България. По отношение на отбраната и сигурността. Тук всичките изследвания на общественото мнение показват, че европейските граждани искат да видят по-сериозен ангажимент от страна на европейските институции при опазване на тяхната физическа сигурност, при социална сигурност по отношение на миграцията. И Европейския съюз може да покаже, да отговори на тези искания с споделянето на отбранителния капацитет, с споделянето на разузнавателната информация. Сега беше скандално, че само няколко страни в Европейския съюз, само няколко специални служби на Европейския съюз споделят информация с Европол. Тероризма няма граници, така че няма как разузнавателната информация, не би трябвало разузнавателната информация да не се обменя в борбата с тероризма и да се стигне, разбира се, до по-глобалния проблем, какво се случва с едни Съединени американски щати, които за първи път след Втората световна война вече не са така сигурни, че ангажиментът им за Европа трябва да бъде само техен ангажимент. И ясно ни заявяват преди някакви години така по, може би умерено, сега доста по-категорично, че вие, европейците, трябва да се вземете в ръце и сами да си гарантирате вашата сигурност, що се отнася особено по отношение на близкото ви съседство, и да не очаквате американският данъкоплатец да ви върши мъжествената работа и вие да се извинявате с това, че сте хуманитарна, давате помощ за хуманитарна помощ или пък за развитие, а нашите войници да загиват в различни точки на света. Казвам го просто така, както ни е поднесено от колегите в Американския конгрес, например. Тук наистина нашата концепция за Европейския съюз като soft power, която сега имахме, има нужда от преразглеждане, без да става въпрос, че трябва да нападаме някои страни, да се милитаризираме, но споделянето на отбранителен капацитет, инвестирането в научна и развойна дейност, в отбранителната индустрия, общото закупуване на техника, общото обучение на военнослужещите от различните видове войски, е нещо, което трябва да е на дневен ред. Разбира се, и общото финансиране на тези операции. Европейския съюз трябва да бъде приеман на сериозно и по отношение на външната политика. Външният министър на Европейския съюз, който трябва да се нарича външният министър на Европейския съюз, да представлява наистина силната позиция на Европа, ние да бъдем и глобален играч, 25% от брутния вътрешен продукт при 7% от населението на света, 25% от световната търговия, 50% разпределяне от всички държавни плащания за социални придобивки. Ние сме изключително голяма сила, Европейския съюз, огромна сила, но ако сме единни, разбира се, тези цифри са заедно с Обединеното кралство. Това като пусне Обединеното кралство, се намаляват цифрите. Това е съвсем ясно. Но въпреки всичко сме силни, ако сме единни. Така че по отношение на отбраната и сигурността, мисля, че Европейската отбранителна общност не замествайки НАТО, а допълвайки капацитета по НАТО и помагайки също така в партньорство с нашите североамерикански партньори. Много интересно темата за търговските споразумения. Използвайте се изключително много за политическа дейност в последните години. Огромен парадокс е, че в страни, които имат огромна полза от експорта и техните икономики са абсолютно експортно ориентирани, техното благоденствие, брутен вътрешен продукт е базиран на експорт, това са Германия и Австрия, има сериозен отпор от части от гражданското общество, мотивирани по различни причини, базирани много често на абсолютни фалшификации и лъжи, срещу свободното търговско, свободното търговие с наши партньори. Ние ако не можем с Канада, като Европейски съюз, да сключим търговско споразумение, то на тази планета ние с абсолютно никой друг не може да сключим. Канада е пример за демокрация и аз не знам на тази планета, не съм на друга страна, която да е по-демократично управлявана или демократична от Канада. Ако имаме каквото и да било съмнение, че има проблем с търговското споразумение с Канада, то не трябва да се откажем от всякаква свободна търговия, от всякакви търговски споразумения. Но виждаме, за съжаление, че темата е много емоционално натоварена и има сериозен отпор, включително и от така, партии, които преди се смятаха за, може би, умерени. Защото, разбира се, се смята, че ако се случи с Канада, следващото ще бъде с Съединените щати, пък там е вече още по-сложно. Завършвам с Шенген и с опазването на външните граници. Това е, трябва да бъде общ споделен капацитет, общ споделен отговорност, извинявайте, на страните членки и тези, които имат външни граници, да чувстват наистина солидарността на другите страни. Никоя страна не трябва да бъде оставена сама да се справя с глобалните предизвикателства. Това допринася за увеличаване на евроскептицизма, използва се от антиевропейски партии, които смятат, че разпространяват всякакви слухове. Наскоро даже чух слух в България от една, може би трябва да бъде проевропейска партия, която казва, ето те ни подготвят да бъдем тук в фармазона и тук ще складират или ще доставят всичките мигранти. Абсолютно неправилно, но това се използва много често от политици в Европейския съюз. И другото е, ние сме призовавали от пленарна зала към националните политици в столиците на страните членки. Не използвайте Европа за боксова круша. Всичко, което не ви отърва, връщайки се в столиците, да кажете, ето Брюксел е неефективен и Брюксел не си е свършил работа. Европейския съюз е това, което страните членки му позволят. Ако не му позволят страните членки да бъде ефективен, той няма да бъде ефективен, защото той е съставен от суверенни страни членки и е цинично, когато се обвинява Европейския институт в неефективност, но не му се дават инструментите и възможностите той да бъде ефективен от същите тези хора, които го обвиняват, че не е ефективен.